worship you. I worship you. I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We're glad to be in the house of God this morning. Thank you so much for being here with us for our Sunday school class. I know that we had to miss a week due to sickness, and we still have several that are sick connected to our church. So we want to be much in prayer for them today. We have several that are not going to be able to be here due to sickness. And so, again, we need to really hold them up to God in prayer. that God will touch and minister to them. Those that are able to be here, so we're glad to for them to be in the house of God, and hope that others are able to come this morning to worship Him in house. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Again, we want to continue to be praying for those that are not able to be here due to sickness. I want to continue to hold them up to God in prayer. If you're in-house, have a prayer request, let me know by lifting your hands. If you're on live stream, you can text the keyword prayer to 205-642-8744, or you can text your prayer request to that number as well. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to today, again, thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity that you've allowed us to come to worship and praise you. Father, today I pray that you'll move and minister in a mighty way in our Sunday school class today. Touch every teacher as they bring forth your word. Father, I pray that you would touch the hearts and lives of every student. Allow your word to resonate into our hearts and our lives today. And Father, I thank you for what you've done in our midst and what you're going to continue to do. Father, I pray that you'll touch this service this morning, minister to each one, and we forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for what you've done and what you're going to continue to do in our midst. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Again, if you have prayer requests, you can text the keyword prayer to 205-642-8744. We are praying for each one of them. The title of our Sunday school lesson today, we're under a unit theme. The unit is Principles for Christian Living. Principles for Christian Living. And this first section, we'll look at the sections in just a moment, but this first section is very, very powerful, and it really, I think, is something that we need in the church world, we need to really focus into. So the principles for Christian living, I can promise you some of these Sunday school lessons, we're going to be revisiting some of these later on, because these are some powerful, powerful Sunday school lessons. Principles for Christian living. The title of our Sunday school lesson today, for today's lesson, is Guarding God's Truth. Guarding God's Truth. We must understand that Christians have got to discern between truth and error. Christians have got to discern between truth and error. I'll bring this back out during our Sunday morning service, because it happens to be a great illustration. But most of you know who, and I normally don't mention names just because I don't want to go down that road, and there's a lot of issues when you mention names, but this is all over the news right now. Most of you know who Kate Middleton is. And over the last week or so, a lot of paparazzi, a lot of actors and actresses from Hollywood, and a lot of folks on social media was saying they was spreading rumor and gossip and stuff about Kate Middleton. She's part of the royal family there in England. And so they was spreading a lot of stuff about her. She's connected there to the royal family. I'll be honest with you, one day I think they're in the family, one day they're out of the family. I don't know which one they're at today. And I'm saying that a little bit of comical, but, I mean, it's the truth. I really don't know where they're at this point, if they're in or out of the family. But the point is, Brother Larry, is there was a lot of social media and paparazzi and news anchors had been spreading a ton of rumor about her over the last 2 weeks. Well, then on Friday, she and her spokesperson, whatever the case may be, they announced that, no, all those things are false. They announced what had been going on, is she has cancer. Well, then Saturday, a ton of Hollywood folks that had been spreading rumor and gossip about her, they started issuing apologies and wishing good wishes towards Kate Middleton and stuff. Here's what this example is for. When I read this particular central truth, Christians must discern between truth and error. What we must understand is, we as a Christian don't get caught up in the rumor and the gossips. Don't get caught up in those things, because I can promise you, and I know this may shock some folks, but the church world is just as bad about gossip and rumor as the secular world. So don't think just because you're a Christian that you don't ever get involved in those things. Now, what we've got, and people will tell me all the time, they'll come to me and they'll ask prayer requests and they'll start telling me things and say, I'm not trying to gossip. And you know, there's a difference between bringing something to your pastor and wanting prayer, and you're not spreading something about somebody else. You're talking about your child or something of that. That's not called gossip. But if Brother Larry came to me and said that Brother Art had told him that so and so had told him that Brother Mike blah blah blah, and Brother Larry's bringing that for prayer, that yeah, that's not exactly, you know, kosher on that. But we must understand, and by the way, they haven't done that, okay? But what we must understand is this is something that is more prevalent, especially with social media and the world we're living in. Just because you read it on social media, just because it's on the news, just because it's on Google, does not mean it's the truth, okay? We've got to discern between truth and error, or truth and a lie. So just remember that. By guarding God's truth, we also must understand that we need to perceive the dangers of deception and walk in the truth. If we start walking in deception, lies, and trickery, we understand that there are dangers in that. So we need to walk in the truth instead of deception and dangers. God's truth is found in salvation and a new life through Jesus Christ. God's truth is found in salvation and new life through Jesus Christ. So if you will, go ahead and turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4, 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1, and it says this, Beloved, do not believe every spirit. Now, if John was writing this today, I think that the verse would have went a little different. I think that it would have said this, Beloved, do not believe everything you hear, you see, that's on the news, that's on television, that's on social media, and that is on Google. All of those follow under that lying spirits, okay? I did not say lying spirits. I said the lying, L-I-N-E spirits. There's a difference. Lying and lying, I know that's, you know, anyways, okay, comical, but do not believe everything you hear. Do not believe everything you see. Because even today, they can take pictures and they can manipulate these things. If you're on social media any, I'm going to go ahead and tell you, I wouldn't click on those things, but you can wind up getting viruses from some of that stuff. But if you're on social media, there's a lot of these games on there that'll take your facial expressions and put a filter on it and stuff. This is the way I look. I want it known that this is the way I look. If I come up missing, I don't want somebody looking for somebody that's got a whole head full of hair. This is the way I look. So, Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. So, in other words, we can test the things and see if it's actually the truth or not. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. What we must understand is just because you see it, just because you hear of it, just because it's on Google does not mean it is true. The church in John, here's you a good one. There's a social media post that's going around that says that Mark Zuckerberg is taking down every chance that he can the postings of the Lord's Prayer. And so people will post that and say, I'm going to see how long this will stay up before Mark Zuckerberg takes this down. He's the owner or whatever of Facebook, the CEO of Facebook and stuff. That's not a truth. They're not taking it down. Just continue on. You want to post the Lord's Prayer? That's awesome. But don't share. Just because it says share this does not mean you need to share it, okay? Now, let's go on. The church in John's day had to grapple between discerning spirits, between the truth and between the spirit of error or spirit of lie. False teachers of apostate times were denying the incarnations, atonement, resurrection, ascension, and intercession of Jesus Christ. We must understand is there was a lot of things going on during that time frame, and they was denying really who Jesus was. Right now, we're setting it in the year of 2024. Gigantic struggles related to the faith are still going on in Christendom. We too must be on guard, lest we fall prey to those who lead us astray. Some forms of communication, podcast, social media, news broadcast, television, newspaper, magazines, they offer a variety of interpretations of the truth, but they are not true. Just because they say, and I know that we're talking about Bible, but just because you hear that so and so political candidate done such and such does not mean it's the truth, okay? And I'm not trying to make this political, but you need to understand that it goes even to that depth, okay? What we must believe and understand is that you're going to know the truth. You need to dig and find it out for yourself. The truth of the Word of God can only be found in the Word of God. Amen? So, you know, we've got to realize there are TikTok preachers. There are TikTok evangelists. Guess what? Just because they say something that makes you feel good, all warm and fuzzy, does not mean it's the truth. There are YouTube preachers and evangelists. Just because they say something that makes you feel all warm and fuzzy does not mean it's the truth. And I know that we broadcast on podcast and we have YouTube channel and all those things. But I tell people all the time, I want you to go back and I want you to look in the Scriptures. That's why I give you so much Scripture, because I don't want you to take my word for it. I want you to dig into the Word of God. Three ways to be able to discern between the truth and a lie. Number one, live close to God. You're going to know the Word of God because you're living close to God. And my sheep know my voice. That's what the Bible says about God. Once we've tasted the goodness of God and we know the grace and the mercy of God, once we know the life kindness of His mercy in our life, you're not easily drawn into error. I have people constantly calling me up and they'll say, or sending me a text message or sending me a Facebook message or something of that nature. And they'll say, oh, you need to go listen to so-and-so and da-da-da-da, this particular evangelist or preacher or something of that nature. And what they say in that particular clip may be great and wonderful, but do you really know that minister? Anybody can say something good, but is their life actually portraying what they're saying? Do you follow what I'm saying? And so that's one of the things you've got to watch out for. Live close to God. Number two, be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit lives inside of you, your witnesses, your spirit is going to bear witness with one another. When the Spirit is inside of us and presenting a message to us, when a message is being presented, you're sitting here in this congregation, or you've joined us on live feed. If I say something and the Holy Spirit of God is living in you and I say something of error, it's going to quicken in you and you're going to know it immediately. I have English teachers that are connected to this church and they know when my grammar ain't right. That ain't the Holy Spirit. That's just, anyway. But we've got, or when I don't pronounce a word right. Brother Tony, I don't know what that is. That ain't the Holy Spirit. What is that? That's the grammar spirit. But what we've got to realize and understand is just like that happens, it's the same way about the Holy Spirit. And so the third thing is we got to know the truth ourselves. You cannot rely on somebody else to just present the gospel to you. You need to know the truth. This last Thursday, I was at the Church of God State Office of Alabama, and the exhorters was there taking the ministry's test to get their exhorter's license. And I had the privilege of doing the devotional and praying before they got started with their test. And in that, I said a sentence. I said, I'm going to pray. It was right there at the very end, and that's what I said. I said, I'm going to pray that the Holy Spirit brings back to your remembrance everything you've studied. Please keep in mind, if you did not study it, the Holy Spirit cannot bring it back to your remembrance. I had a lot of giggles in there. And by the grades, I know exactly what they knew exactly what I was talking about. What we've got to realize and understand is if we've not read it, we've not dug into the Word of God, it's not going to be there in our spirit. Amen? So let's take a look. This first section is a very big section. The first section is God is greater than our feelings. I have said this. I have said this since the beginning of my ministry. We do not walk by our feelings. We walk by our faith. The Bible tells us we walk by faith and not by sight. Sight is a part of our feeling. It is something, it's an interaction on the secular, on the humanity side, on the human side. And what we've got to realize and understand is we need to walk in our faith in God, not by our faith in our own self, our own emotion, our own feeling. I'm not denying that emotions and the way we feel, I'm not denying that those things are not a part of our lives, because they very much are. But we must understand we do not walk by our feelings, because God is greater than our feelings. I'm going to tell you, if we walk by our feelings, there's many times I wouldn't be at church, because I don't feel like being there. Whether it be feelings as far as how I feel physically about sickly or anything of that nature, or it's feeling like, well, you know what? So-and-so's mad at me. So-and-so's done this. So-and-so's upset. I don't want to go up there and see them. We don't walk by our feelings. God is greater than our feelings. So let's take a look. You'll be looking at 1 John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, verses 19 through 24. 1 John chapter 3, 19 through 24. Let's take a look at 19 through 22. 1 John chapter 3, let's start in verse 19, read through 22. By this we shall know that we are of the truth. Reassure our heart before Him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart. Now, biblically, the heart in the Bible, the reason it's referred to as the heart is, what is the heart? The heart, biblical times and in today's time, the heart is the seat of emotion. Book of Proverbs says, the heart is deceitful. The heart is evil. What we've got, I don't know why does not understand that. God is greater than our heart. What is the heart? The heart is the seat of emotion. And God knows everything. Verse 21. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive of Him, because we keep His commandments and do what pleases Him. It's not enough to only say we love one another. We must demonstrate our love in deed and in truth. This goes back to what I said a moment ago. And I'm not trying to knock a televangelist. I'm not trying to knock a YouTube evangelist. And I'm not trying to knock a TikTok evangelist. But just because they can say something that sounds all warm and fuzzy all over, but if their life does not live it, then that is a huge thing. What we must understand is if a TikTok or a YouTube or a televangelist is saying something warm and fuzzy, and we think it sort of leans towards the truth, we need to understand, are they walking in that truth? It's not enough to say we love one another. It's not enough to say something about the Word of God. We need to walk in that. It's in deed and in truth. That's verse 18. It's not a part of our scriptures, but verse 18 talks about that. Verse 19 tells us, we know we belong to the truth. When we are saying something and we're walking in it, we know we belong to the truth. Amen? I can tell my wife I love her. I can tell her I love her with all my heart.
But if she asks me to take the trash out, and I sit there on the couch and I say, I ain't doing it. You do it yourself. Am I demonstrating? Y'all notice that she's not in here. Mm-hmm. Am I demonstrating that love? No. What we've got to understand and realize is we need to not only say it, but we need to walk it and demonstrate it in deed and in action. There are many times we struggle with our standing with God because of past sins. Satan stands ready to point an accusing finger at us, causing us to doubt our relationship with God. But verse 20 tells us plainly. Verse 20 says, God is greater. God's greater than any accusation. God is greater than our heart. God is greater than our emotions. God is greater than our feelings. When God knows us better than we know ourselves, forgiving us of our wrongdoings, He lifts us out of our guilt and gives us peace within our hearts and our minds. That's verse 21. Guilt is gone. We can come boldly to the throne room of grace, believing He'll meet our every need. There are so many times people will say, Brother Andy, God, there's no way that God would forgive me. You don't understand all the things I've done. You don't understand all. We're the ones, humanity is the ones that puts a level on sin. God doesn't see this sin is a 10 and this one's a 5 and that one's a 13. God doesn't see it that way. God sees sin as sin. That's it. We're the ones that puts it greater. So in God's eyes, murder is just along the same line as lying. Amen? And what we've got to realize and understand is that's the way God sees it. And if God can forgive a liar, He can forgive a murderer. If there is true repentance in that heart and in that life. When guilt is gone, we now can go with confidence before God. Verse 22, John gives us reasons why our prayers are answered. The first reason is, we obey the commands of God. I may not feel like it. I may not act like I want to do it. But if I'm obeying the commands of God, things are going to go so much better in our lives. If we will just obey what God has commanded to us and we follow the direction and the leadership of God, things turn out better in our lives. Amen? I told somebody the other day, I said, if you look at people's lives. This is not a judgment, okay? You're not passing judgment on anybody. But if you start looking at people's lives and their lives have turned upside down, their lives are just all cattywonkered and it just is discombobulated, and you start looking at what's going on, you'll find an attraction somewhere or another to a lifestyle of sin. And this is a prime example. This is the biggest example that I know to give. If you find somebody that is having a true financial crisis in their lives, and they come to you and they say, Brother Andy, I just need you to pray that God will help me financially. Just finances are just all upside down. The first thing that I've ever looked at, and people don't like it when you do it, is are you giving in your tithes and offerings? And if they say no, I will tell them, whether they want to hear it or not, that's why your finances are upside down. Well, I can't afford to pay my tithes and offerings because I got to pay the power bill. I got to do this. I can't afford not to pay, because if I do pay my tithes and offerings and I don't pay it, as in it's a bill, I happily give it back to God. God takes care of that power bill, that water bill, the grocery bill, the gas bill. God will take care of those things if we do what God's command. That's just one example of many that you could give. When we obey God's commands and we walk in the will of God, having resigned ourselves to the will of God, our prayers will then be based on our faith and not our feeling. If we base our prayers on faith, knowing that God can do it, then we have set aside doubt. We have set aside confusion. We have set aside discontentment. And when we pray a prayer of faith that God is going to take care of, then wisdom and power from God is going to bring the desired result. Here's what I mean by that. If we're following what God's commanded, we are following the Word of God, we are following the will of God for our lives, we're doing what God has called us to do. You may not have $1 million in your checking account, but you're going to have your needs met. Amen? That's a big difference. Many times people will say, oh, I want to be able to continue to do this wasteful spending and still do all this other stuff, and I should have $1 million in my checking account. That's not the way this thing works. God wants to see, are you going to be faithful over what He's given you before He gives you more? Okay? This is the Word of God. The second reason that God answers our prayer is because we do things that pleases God. Our relationship with God is genuine, and it's without pretense and without hypocrisy. If we have a true relationship with God, we're going to do things that truly pleases God. Biggest thing is we're going to make sure we're in His house. We're going to make sure that we're witnessing as we should. I understand people are not able to. There's some people that's not going to be here today due to sickness, and I get that. I 100% am all on board on that. I've always been on board with that, even way before any sicknesses was there. I'm all on board with that. But what we've got to understand is the sickness of lazyitis doesn't count. If we are doing what pleases God, our relationship with Him is going to be genuine. And if we've got a genuine relationship with God, we're going to want to do things without pretense and hypocrisy. We're going to want to do things for God. What an incentive this is to live our lives righteously, to love God unreserved. God honors that life and that attitude. I've told people before, I give my tithes and offerings, I give it for a selfish reason. And here's what I mean by that. It's not about hypocrisy. I'm not doing it hypocritically, because I tell you straight up, I'm giving my tithes and offering because I want what God's Word has for my life. If I want God to give back to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So therefore, I'm going to give in my tithes and offerings. And I'm using money, not because I'm trying to beg for money. I'm trying to, everybody understands finances, especially right now when loaf of bread is $6 a loaf. You know, I mean, everybody understands finances are tight. I mean, you know, Sister Carrie go to the grocery store and credit card thing says $176, and I'm thinking she's got a trunk load, and she comes home with four bags. That's a problem, okay? That's a huge problem. What we've got to realize and understand is finances are tight, but I know I'm going to continue to give my tithes and offerings. Why? Because I want the blessings of God. I want to do those things that's going to be pleasing to God, because I want Him to bestow blessings back onto my life. Does all of that make sense? And I want us to, we need to understand those things. My feet, I hope that makes sense. If it doesn't, put a comment or text it to the church. We want to make sure that you understand what we're saying on that. The Scripture makes it clear that whatever we ask according to God's will in the name of Jesus for His sake, Jesus says, you pray in my name, you're going to receive what you have asked for. Matthew 7, verse 7 and 8 tells us, ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened. For everyone that asks is going to receive. He that seeks is going to find. And to him that knocks, it will be opened. Later on in John's writing, in 1 John chapter 5, 14 and 15, John tells us this. Now, this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to God's will, God hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have petitions because we've asked it of Him. We know that if we're living the life of God that God wants us to live, if I ask, God's going to grant. Amen? So let's take a look at verse 23 and 24. 1 John chapter 3, 23 and 24. This is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. John sums up our duty as it relates to keeping Christ's commandments in these two words. In verse 23, he ties everything up in two words. The words believe and the word love. We believe and we love one another. To believe and to love is the greatest and most important command ever been issued from the throne room of God. If this is neglected, no other command can be kept. Why? Because if we believe that God is, if we believe in the name of the Son of Jesus Christ, and we love one another, everything else is going to fall into place. If you love your neighbor as yourself, you're not going to want to steal from them, right? If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, then you're going to keep God first in your life. You're going to obey what God has commanded. You're going to remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. You're going to honor your father and mother if you are loving one another. You see those things. All of those things tie back to believe and to love. Believe and love go hand in hand. Both are the will of God. Both are commanded by God. And they represent right belief, right conduct, and are a test of the true believer. In John chapter 13, 34 and 35, Jesus says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this you know you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." The love we show one to another is to be molded after the love that Christ has for us. This love puts us first and is quick and easily to forgive others. Some people have said, they've asked me, they'll say, "Do you hold a grudge?" No, I don't hold a grudge. I forgive easily. I forgive. But it doesn't mean that I'm not going to remember, hey, so-and-so, what's going on? What's happening? What's taking place? What does that mean? That doesn't mean, look, if you steal from me, I may forgive you, but it doesn't mean I'm going to give you access to my possessions anymore. Does that make sense? Oh, that's not biblical. Oh, yes, it is. It's not putting that temptation back in front of them. Does that make sense? You know, we've said this before. If somebody steals from a church, you can forgive them, but there's still restitution, right? Okay, those things are biblical. People forget that those things also go hand in hand. I can forgive, but they've got to go through their process as well. Amen? They've got to have a repentant heart. They have got to. So me forgiving has nothing to do with eliminating that restitution on their life, eliminating that repentance in their heart and their life as well. There's two separate things going on there. Belief and love always goes hand in hand. Love has got to be considered one of the cardinal virtues of a Christian life. More than any other characteristic, love is what distinguishes believers and identifies them as a follower of Christ. Because Christians are supposed to show the love of God to everybody. I've used this example before, how that I, you know, when 9/11 happened, and
when we had the war going on, when all of those things was going on, and Saddam Hussein was a part of all of it. I mean, you know, you didn't turn the news on, you didn't hear his name at least once, twice, three, four times a week. Things that's going on, things that's happening. And I told a church one time that I want Saddam Hussein to be saved. I wanted him to have that opportunity for salvation. Oh, all the things he's done, bless God, he better not get saved. No, that's not showing the love of God. Showing the love of God is wanting salvation for all mankind, regardless of what they've done to us. That includes your next door neighbor that their pine tree keeps getting pine straw and pine cones all in your yard and you're having to clean it up. That's still showing the love of God for them. I love these YouTube videos. This guy, he's cleaning up pine straw and pine cones out of his yard. And what is he doing? He's throwing them all in the neighbor's yard. Boy, that's showing the love of God right there, ain't it? What we've got to realize and understand, you know, waiters and waitresses have said that the worst day to work at a restaurant is on a Sunday. Why? Church folks. Church folks. What we've got to realize and grab a hold of is we need to show the love of God to everybody. They're there serving us our food. You need to show the love of God towards them, amen? You need to be nice to them, because guess what? Believe it or not, they can mess up your food. I'm definitely going to show the love of God towards them. I want my food right. What we've got to, I say that jokingly to any waiter or waitress that may be watching, okay? What we've got to realize and understand is we as children of God, that is what distinguishes us from anybody else, is us showing the love of God. Take a look at verse 24. Verse 24 says, as God's children, we dwell in God and God dwells in us. This is evident by us keeping God's commandments. Those who consequently obey God's commandments enjoy a relationship with God and Jesus Christ. Paul affirms this relationship when he spoke of Christ indwelling in our hearts through faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love and may be able to comprehend with the saints what is the width, length, depth, and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be able to be filled with all the fullness of God. Ephesians chapter 3, 17 through 19. The abiding of the Father and of the Son is in us. But why? Because of our relationship with Jesus Christ and our relationship with God. It's more than a religion. It's a relationship. The Holy Spirit abides within us as well to assist us to exercise our faith and every other grace. Everybody heard this verse? The flesh is, the Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Why is the flesh weak? Because of our emotion, our feelings, all of those things. Well, they hurt my feelings. I don't want to go over there to them. I don't want to talk. It doesn't matter about those things. We need to just lace up our bootstraps, tighten up our belt, and show the love of God. Have you ever heard the phrase, kill them with kindness? When people have done you wrong, that's when you go to them and you show the love of God to them. That's why I've told y'all, there's been many a times I've chased people around Walmart. Because I'm going to kill them with kindness. I don't care how bad how evil they've been towards me. I'm going to make them say hello to me. What we've got to realize and we've got to understand is we need to continuously show the love of God to those around us. The Holy Spirit abides within us to assist us. Do you think that without the Holy Spirit of God that we could show the love of God to the others around? No. The Holy Spirit inspires us to confess before others that Jesus is the Son of the living God. The Holy Spirit provides the common bond that enables us to love one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. He empowers us to live righteously. Apart from the indwelling of the Spirit,
we are incapable of carrying out distinguishing marks of a Christian life. People say that I need the Holy Spirit to go to heaven. No, I need the Holy Spirit to go to Walmart. I need the Holy Spirit to go to the restaurants. I need the Holy Spirit to go out the front door every day. What we must understand is the Holy Spirit is there to help us show the love of God. And the Holy Spirit helps us to learn to discern God's truth. The Holy Spirit is there to help us to know the truth of God. Take a look at 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, verses 1, 2, and 3. 1 John chapter 4, let's read verse 1, 2, and 3. Beloved, do not believe every Google search. Do not believe every television ad. Do not believe every news anchor. Do not believe everything you see, hear, or told. Do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. There's one of the states that their phrase is the show me state. I'm going to tell you something. It's sad to be in the way we are in this world today, but people tell me a lot of stuff. And until I have a reason to know that you've lied to me, I believe that you've told me the truth. If Stan comes in and told me it's raining outside right now, until I know different, I believe he's told me the truth. But I can look right out that window and I can know it ain't raining outside. Now I have tested to see if he's told me. Now Stan didn't come in here and tell me that it was raining outside. Don't everybody throw anything at him. But the point is we, until I have a reason to know somebody's lied to me, I believe you told me the truth. I am that way. I believe that people tell me the truth. But now once you've told me your first lie and I know that's a lie, everything else you tell me, I'm going to doubt. Oh, Brother Andy, that's not being biblical. Oh, yes, it is. Do not believe every spirit. I'm not going to believe that lying spirit. I mean, hello. Test to see if it's from God or not. Why? Because there are many, and I'm using something very, very simple. It's raining or not. Every one of us can look out the window and tell if it's raining or not, right? So it would be absolutely foolish for somebody to come in here and say, y'all, it's raining outside. Oh, really? But what we've got to realize and understand is there are many false prophets. We're talking about something as silly as rain, but there are false prophets that are trying, they've gone out into the world to spread lies of the devil, and they are dealing with things that's a whole lot more serious than whether or not it's raining or not, right? We've got to know whether the Spirit is from God or not. Look at verse 2. By this you're going to know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has gone in the flesh, has come in the form of the flesh, is from God. Verse 3. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. It is plain and simple. Look, here's what I don't get. Here's what I don't get. There are so many people that doubt that Jesus was the Son of God, that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again, and is now ascended at the end of the heavens. I know that sounds silly to you and I because we all believe those things. But there are so many that doubt that. There's so many people that doubt many more things. But guess who does believe 100%? Lucifer. I mean, you think about this. The devil knows those things existed. The devil knows those things happened. But yet he is going to do everything he can to spread lies and deceit in the form of those false prophets. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming. And guess what? Verse 3 right here is just as plain as the nose on our face and is happening right here, right now. You couldn't get a truer statement out of the Bible right here. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming, and now is in the world already. The spirit of the Antichrist is not a new thing. John wrote this. I'm going to say almost 2,000 years ago. I don't know exact year time frame that this particular passage was wrote. So it may be 2,022 years ago. It may be 1,995 years ago. This verse was written almost 2,000 years ago. And it says, the spirit of the Antichrist is already in the world. Then, you better believe the spirit of the Antichrist is in the world today. Amen? We see it everywhere we look. We know that the spirit of Antichrist is here. False prophets is not a new thing. People spreading lies and deceit and deception, this is not a new thing. You can look in the Old Testament and you see many examples of those who pretend to be of God and they're not. The criteria for determining the difference between a true and a false prophet is simply this. If a prophecy comes to pass, it came from a true prophet. If it didn't come to pass, the speaker was a false prophet. That's Deuteronomy chapter 18. The same is true in the New Testament, and it's true in our times today. I'm not going to claim to be a prophet. I'm not going to claim to give you prophecy, but I'm going to give you something from the Word of God. The spirit of the Antichrist is in the world today and has been in the world for over 2,000 years. The spirit of the Antichrist wants nothing more than to deceive and bring deception to mankind. This is why here's the problem. The church world has allowed that to infiltrate the church, and that's why you see a decline of the church. I mean, that's the truth right there. This is why you see a decline of the church. But there is a remnant of people that still believes that God is still God. That Jesus Christ is still the Son of God. That He died, He was buried, and He rose again. Everything else is of non-significance. Yes, we believe that Noah had the ark and he took his eight family members, him and his seven family members. They all went on the ark and they were saved. We know that's the truth. Why do we try to get into a theological argument with somebody that's not saved over that? Don't do it. Don't do it. Now, I love talking to church folks, and I love talking to Bible scholars and stuff over those things. Don't do it to a non-Christian. It's of no use. Why? They're not going to believe it anyway. What we've got to realize and understand is all that we need to present is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The test that John wanted his readers to use was an attitude that believer has towards Jesus Christ. I was watching a video the other day, and the speaker, the commentator on this video, the main speaker on this video, asked this young lady, said, "Why are you wearing a cross necklace? Why are you wearing a cross necklace?" And the reason the question was asked was because this person was definitely anti-religious, anti-relationship with Jesus Christ, anti-a belief in God. This person was definitely an anti-Christ spirit. And so the commentator asked, "Why are you wearing a cross necklace?" And this young lady said, "Because it looks pretty." Not because of a meaning or anything of that nature. We've got to understand is there are so many today, they have forgotten the meaning of the cross. They've forgotten the meaning of the blood of Jesus Christ. It's not that it's pretty. It's that the blood was shed there for my sins. Amen? There is a meaning behind that. Those who deny Jesus was around the world, and they are today, and they are inspired by the spirit of the Antichrist. Verse 3. At the end times, the Antichrist will refuse to acknowledge Jesus and will try to set himself up as the real Christ. This spirit has been present for over 2,000 years. way longer than 2,000 years. Even though Christ was not around in Moses' time, there was an Antichrist spirit going on at that time. There's an Antichrist spirit going on today. But no matter how smooth talking, no matter how charismatic, no matter how charming, no matter how persuasive that person might be, if they do not embrace Jesus Christ and His message completely, they must be recognized as a false prophet. It's so amazing to me how that people will grab a hold to one segment, and that's the hill they're going to die on. That's what they're going to fight against, or that's what they're going to fight for. That's what they're going to do. They don't believe about anything else. That's all they push. That's all they've got. Church, we've got to understand. We have got to believe the entirety of God's Word. We don't have the luxury of tearing out pages out of a Bible and throwing them to the side. We have got to believe the entirety of the Word of God. Amen? There are many in the world today that they're going to throw parts of it out because it doesn't fit their narrative. I've had too many people tell me the New Testament doesn't preach anything about, the New Testament doesn't talk anything about tithing. They've never read the New Testament. They tell me, they'll say the New Testament doesn't talk anything against homosexual, gays, and lesbian lifestyle. They've never read the New Testament. There are so many. I read the number this morning, and it was like 39,000 is the number. 39,000 plus is the number of references from the New Testament that ties back into the Old Testament. You cannot have one without the other. They tie together. Everything in the Bible ties together. We cannot eliminate parts of the Word of God just because it don't fit our narrative. Let's go on to the last section of our Sunday school lesson. I hope y'all go back and read these Sunday school lessons and study these Sunday school lessons, but There's no way I could ever get all of a Sunday school lesson in. Hold to the truth about Christ. We need to beware of deceivers. We need to be aware of deceivers and deception. Take a look at 2 John chapter 1. 2 John chapter 1. We're going to read, let's start off reading verse 7 through 9. 2 John chapter 1. Verses 7 through 9. For many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. Do you know that the religious leaders of Jesus' day, they knew the prophecies of the Old Testament better than anybody else? The religious leaders, the Sadducees and the Pharisees, those religious leaders, they knew the prophecies inside and out of the Old Testament as referring to, of any topic, but mainly referring to the first coming of the Messiah, of Jesus Christ. Those religious leaders of the day, they knew inside and out everything that was spoken out of the Old Testament concerning the coming of Jesus the first time. They knew He would come as a babe in a manger. They knew a star would appear. They knew everything about this Messiah from the Old Testament. Yet, they were the ones that rejected Jesus as the Messiah. Today's Palm Sunday. So all these years ago on Palm Sunday, way back when, the religious leaders were standing back. They was like, we got to do whatever we can to get rid of this dude. He's upsetting our apple cart. He's causing havoc and mayhem. He's causing people to reject our rule and our law and our way of things. But you know what? They was part of that deceivers, because they was doing everything they could to be an anti-Christ spirit in the world then. Go to verse 8. Watch yourself so that you may not lose what we have worked for, but we may win a full reward. Verse 9. Everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teachings of Christ does not have God. Whoever abides in the teachings has both the Father and the Son. In his second letter, John repeats a former warning about the coming of messengers who represent the spirit of Antichrist. These messengers who are deceivers, whose mission it is to lead people. This is the only thing that, and they infiltrate the church world. They infiltrate social media. We talked about the TikTok evangelists, the YouTube evangelists, these tele-evangelists. I'm not talking about all of them. There's many of them that are great and wonderful. But you've got to know who they are that are speaking a word in your life. They may be up there saying something, and they do not live it. You got to watch about these people speaking into your life. Amen? You got to be very, very cautious about this. Let me ask live feed. Have I named anybody? I know I muted my mic a while ago and I said a name. But I've not named anybody. I'm not talking about anybody particular. But I'm telling us, you got to know about these people that are speaking into your life. Why? You can go all the way back to the very beginning of this. You can go all the way back to the very beginning. There are messengers whose sole purpose is to be a deceiver and to lead people astray. They are refusing to acknowledge Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. You've got to be careful about who is speaking a word into your life. They can tickle your ear all day long. The Bible reveals that Jesus did not become the Son of God at his birth, his baptism, and he did not cease to be the Son of God at his death on the cross. He was the Son of God before he was born. He was the Son of God while on earth, from birth until death, and today he is still the Son of God. Nothing changed about that. We find in verse 8 that John warned the believers, "Do not be taken by the spirit of error, thus lose the fruit of their labors in the kingdom. Rather than accepting and spreading false teachings, they are hearing and they need to continue to declare the doctrine they have heard and embraced from the beginning of their Christian journey. If they remain faithful to the truth, they'll receive the full benefits of the rewards due them." John's message is also corresponding into what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 when he says this, "Now who plants and he who waters, and each one will receive his own reward according to his labor. If anyone's work which he has built on endures, he will receive a reward." No matter what we do, good, bad, and ugly, we're going to receive a reward based on what our labor has been. I don't need to do the bad. I don't need to do the ugly. I need to do the good that God has called us to do. The danger of denying Christ is just as real then and it is real today. There are multitudes of people. They'll say that Jesus is the Son of God. You had a pastor of a very large church in Texas. You had a Pentecostal church, fairly large, and I'm talking thousands of people, and the pastor was an atheist. The pastor was a homosexual atheist. He was the pastor of that church for many, many years, and the church folks never knew it.
You can go back and you can listen to his teachings today, knowing what you know now. And guess what? Oh, it's evident in it. It's evident in what he's teaching and preaching that he does not believe the word of God. It is very evident. Let me just tell you something. In case anybody wants to know whether I believe in the word of God or not, Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ was the Son of God. And tomorrow Jesus Christ will still be the Son of God. I have faith that every word, every I, every tittle, everything, every jot, every command in the word of God is the word of God. And we have got to follow God's word. Those things, especially what I just mentioned, those things are very discouraging. It's disheartening. It causes us to lose hope in humanity. You know what? My hope is not built in humanity. My hope is not built in what human nature can do. My hope is built on my faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We must always remember, we must always understand, it's not about what man does, but it is about what God has done in my life. Amen? Live feed, thank you so much for joining with us. Continue to join with us in just a few moments as we start our Sunday morning worship. May the good Lord bless you is our prayer. See you back in about 15 minutes for our Sunday morning worship. May God bless you. Amen.